So, so that's not to be so my point is, that shouldn't be a discouraging word, that's an encouraging word, because what'll make the difference is one person not submitting to that form or way of getting to the end, and someone who stays true to themselves and their experience with God in their prayer time, in their making the right choices in their life, in their obedience, and in their asking for forgiveness when they mess up, and they're studying scripture, and they're reading inspired readings of people they consider to be leaders, and you're limiting your social time and your frequent interactions with others with those who either are inspiring to you or are open to your sharing of your divinities, for lack of a better phrase, then you're kind of in a position where you can really model what that change is. So it's sort of like I'm saying, you know, don't worry about the end, be the end. You know, there isn't really a means to an end. We are the end, and by that I mean Christ has died so that we could have access to all that is powerful, spiritual, transcendent, that can, you know, revitalize our mortal bodies and carnal, selfish, egoic thinking. So he's already done that. He's resident in us. We are wedded with him. We're joint heirs with him. In a sense, he is the bridegroom. We are the bride. We are one with him, even as he is one with the Father. So if we have that oneness, that power to transcend, then we've arrived. The only difference is we're going to grow in our demonstration of having arrived. And that becomes more and more apparent by just sort of staying true to that present state of communication and oneness in our communication with God, in our communication with others, and in our communication with ourselves, so to speak. And by that I mean not hiding from, you know, things that you need to work on and patterns of mind and behavior that need to be broken. You know, you're honest with God about that. You're seeking support and strength to overcome that, and you're, you know, claiming the power and ability to do that through the death of Christ and his resurrected spirit that's available to all of us after having accomplished God's work. He's done it in our place so that we could be joined with him in that place of access to God. So therefore, this whole idea of, all right, how do we now get from point A, where we are now, to where we want to be, point B, revitalized and transformed. I think it's more of a daily practice of confessing what is now true and forever, and not conforming to any particular pattern of living to get there. Now, it's probably sounding a little bit contradictory or paradoxical. I'll try to parse it out for you. Let's see. some things I should say and some things I shouldn't. Let's see. Well, I guess one of the things, I guess what I'm talking about is just like practicing the presence of God, basically. And so it's not something that's a burden. It's not something that feels heavy. It's not something that you don't want to do. It's something in you that is just has to be done because the life of God is in you, and God just wants to love, and God just wants to give, and God just wants to serve, and God just wants to have this overcoming presence and power of the Spirit to be so animated in us that it is as tangible as what the disciples and the contemporaries of Jesus saw by observing his behavior in human form. It really shouldn't be any different than that. So what I'm saying is, by practicing like remaining in the presence and the Spirit of God all day, every day, no one situation really is any different from another, in the sense that the foundation is, I'm here as a representative of God. I'm here to love others. I'm here to serve wherever I see it appropriate and fitting. And when I see that and the opportunity is mine to give, then I give. And sometimes giving could be being silent. How's that? How is silence a gift to somebody else? Well, for instance, you might be confronted with a peer at work and they are complaining. And you're just thinking, no, do not go there. And so instead of just feeding into it and saying, oh, I know, that guy is ridiculous. When is he going to stop? Instead of that, you know, you just continue eating your tuna melt sandwich with, you know, a nice crust on the top and a nice cold green tea drink. And you don't say anything. And maybe the other person will get the idea, all right, they're not feeding into that. I guess maybe I should change the subject. Now maybe they move to something less self-centered, less critical, and they're kind of into an area where now you can help develop that and get it, the discussion, off self and off criticism and off negativity. So in that sense, your silence was a gift and the person bought it. All right, how about in another situation where you're in the same situation, but the complainer doesn't recognize your silence as a gift, and they kind of go, what's wrong with you? You're not gonna say anything? You know, usually you say something here about what a jerk so-and-so is. And you go, well, I'm practicing to be positive, so I help show others that there's a better way to live, and sometimes just dwelling on this kind of negativity just isn't fruitful. And I'm like, tell me about that. So then you could, you know, as much as, you know, you feel is appropriate, you could share what's going on. Now, I'm not one of those that thinks, oh, open door, preach Jesus to them immediately, ask them if they're saved, if they're not, lead them through the sinner's prayer and put a notch on your salvation belt and get your brownie points in heaven. No, you need to be sensitive. It could be a time to to share the name of Christ and very personally what's going on with you, but you really want to sense, you know, where somebody's at. And I think, you know, if you have the Spirit, you know, resident in you, you'll know like how much you should or shouldn't say. So you don't want, you know, if there's a chance there for a relationship, you know, don't just, you know, become so bold in your doctrine that you now just like cut off that opportunity with that person. You say, oh, I planted the seed and it's up to God to water it. So it's up to them to make a choice. And it's sort of like, you've done your job, you feel self-sufficient and satisfied, and it's up to them. They rejected Christ, so it's not your problem. When really I look at that as like, no, you created a problem by presenting it in a way that was offensive to the person, and now they don't want to talk to you anymore. Having said that, I wouldn't back away from something just because it appears that someone would necessarily reject it, because that will always be the case with the gospel. You know, I forget where it is in scripture, and somebody will help me with this. I think, you know, Paul says somewhere, I was going to say Galatians, but I'm just pulling needles out of a haystack. You know, that the gospel always, in Christ, will always be a stumbling block. You know, he's the foundation of this message, and that will always be the stumbling block for people, because that's what they resist. I don't want to hear about Christ because I want to continue my life the way I am. You're preaching Jesus to me. That sounds like I need to change something. I don't want to change anything. Who are you to tell me? Weren't you the person I saw at the bar the other month? And blah, blah, blah. I mean, it just gets ridiculous. So it's always going to be, the message is always going to be a stumbling block. But that doesn't mean we need to be bulls in a series of china shops. That's all I'm saying. And I think there's a lot of Christians out there who sort of feel like, I really find this annoying. They feel like empowered and, what's the right word? Not entitled. I don't know. In a sense, I just feel like they feel like they've been ordained by God because of their faith to now preach the gospel in any way, shape, or form to as many people as possible and let the chips fall where they may. And I just find that to be very insensitive and not reflective of Christ. However, there are places to be bold and say whatever needs to be said, and it may be an offense, but in your spirit you sort of sense that this is a time where you have to be called as a witness to the reality of Christ, and you need to stand firm no matter what the consequence. That's very different from developing a relationship with someone and you're looking for ways to communicate with them with the best possible outcome. And so you know what you ultimately want to say, but you're kind of waiting for the right time and place to say it in that way that it can best be received. Now, having said that, that might sound like it's contradictory to what I originally was talking about, which is staying away from a form or a particular means towards a certain end. No, the difference here of which I'm speaking is that there is no particular, you're not adhering to a particular form or method or structure for that end to, you know, help someone make a decision to become a Christian.